Something a bit different today. You remember these lockpicks that I opened in the last mailbag? The cheapest possible ones that I could find on eBay. Well, let's take a look at them. I give a brief overview in the mailbag, but basically the kit came with 9 picks and 2 tensioning tools. So when you're opening a lock, there's 2 different things that you have to do. The first one is you have to put a little bit of rotation on it, the same as the key would, and that causes the pins inside to bind up. And then the second thing that you do is use the actual pick to lift the pins inside the lock, and the pins are the bits that are the pieces that push down into each of these, or I guess are lifted up by each of these cuts. Inside the lock there's a bunch of pins. Where do I have some over here? Yeah, I do have some. Bunch of pins like these. That pointy bit actually is what engages with the cuts in the key. And then stacked on top of those is another set of pins called driver pins, which are just pure cylinders normally. Well, some of them can have some funky shapes to try and resist picking and other attempts to open them. And then above that, there is a spring pushing down on the whole thing. It pushes down and pushes it down into the key. The key lifts them up. And where the break is between the 2 pins, the key basically lifts that break up to line up with this line right here. And when it does, then there that break in the pin, called the shear line, allows this guy to rotate and the lock unlocks. Without the pins pushed up, or without the pins pushed up to the proper spot, then the lock won't rotate. Although you see there's a little bit of slop in there. It's not perfectly held. It moves a millimeter or so, a few degrees. That is what you exploit, that sloppiness, when you're going to pick the lock. So now that I've got some pressure rotating, and most locks, it doesn't matter which way you go, clockwise or counterclockwise. Now that I've got some pressure on there, I can take the pick and just go through and until I find which one of those pins is actually the one that's jamming it up. And then I just lift those up, and when I get it high enough that the shear line, or the break in the pin hits the shear line, I can feel it, and sometimes you can hear it, kind of click into place, which means that one is no longer binding. So now you go along and find the next one that's binding, and you just keep repeating that until you've got all 5, in this case, or all of the pins, up. And then the lock will rotate and be open. Now, I'm not good enough at this to get this lock while I'm talking to you. Wouldn't that be awesome? But that's the basic principle. So now then, these, with that background out of the way, these picks are, I found that they're fairly thick in this dimension here. The profiles of them, the shapes of them, are all slightly different, which is good, because you've got a variety of different sizes of openings in locks, a variety of different keyholes, and they're different shapes, and they have different little bits on the side here. These things here, which engage into grooves in the length of the key, those are called warding, and part of what they do is keep the wrong brand of key, or the wrong type of key, from going in. And part of what they do is to foil somebody who's trying to open it, because they get in your way. These two are fairly wide open, so these picks slide in there pretty easily. This is a smaller lock. This is actually like a desk drawer lock, and And you see it's got a little rewarding in there too. It's smaller, but this key, or this pick still fits in there width-wise. But watch what happens when you try and put a tensioning tool in there. Actually, the tensioning tool gets jammed up on the warding on that one. See, this one's a little bit narrower. And no, it doesn't want to go in either. You can sort of put it in the top there a little bit, but then you don't have room to get the pick in. So you need a different size tensioning tool. This one, actually, this is just a cheap padlock, but I don't know. These fit in there too. I want this one. It fits in there too. Here we go. This is a medical lock. This is an expensive high security lock. And this pick jams up on the warding. I can't get it around. So you need a narrower pick. And these are quite thick picks by lockpicking standards. They are 0.8 millimeters. Or for those of you in the States and nowhere else in the world, they are 31 thousandths of an inch thick, which is pretty thick by lockpick standards. Where now is, here's the ones that I made before I got these, and they are made out of a little bit thinner material. Some are stainless steel packing straps. See, that one's 22 thousandths. Or 0.58 millimeters, 0.52 millimeters, or 20 thousandths. Different thicknesses. What is this one? 21 thousandths. So those slide into these smaller locks a lot easier. There's that one other thing that I had here. Oh yeah, this is another high security keyway. This is a Best brand. This particular one's been damaged and taken out, so it doesn't have any pins, but even with this skinnier pick, it just barely fits in there. These ones, not a chance. So they're cheap, which is why they're not, yeah, they're not the best, the most universal, but they will open locks like this, which is a Wiser keyway, which is incredibly common. And oh yeah, you saw me working on it easier earlier. This one's a Dominion lock, which is pretty old school brand. And again, it fits in there. That's a, that one's too deep. I'm gonna get this shallower hook. The deep hook, the different depths of hooks, have, you use them in different situations depending on the shape of the lock. Again, I mean, that's why, ho ho ho, isn't that cool? I didn't actually expect to be able to do that on camera. That's awesome. Anyway, the different shapes, what I was getting at, the different shapes of the keyways, keyholes, is why you need, your most lockpickers want to have different thicknesses and different shapes of hooks. You see, those are fairly, I mean, they don't look all that different, too much different, until you start playing with them. And then you notice how much difference even just that subtle difference makes. Anyway, this was kind of supposed to be a bit of a review, so let's try and do that rather than just teaching lockpicking. So these are very magnetic, a very positive slam on them when I stack that in. These are made out of a better stainless steel, and the magnet just barely sticks to them. It does, but not very strongly. This particular one's made out of a pipe strap. These are made out of some other kinds of strapping, tension tools that I've made. out of various different things, including that I think is the piece of stainless steel out of a windshield wiper. That's not stainless steel. That's spring steel. Oh, okay. So that one was actually off of a street sweeper bristle, of all things, that that fell off a street sweeping machine. What is this? This is, again, not very magnetic. The reason I'm checking for magnetism is the highest quality stainless steels, which are going to be very strong for their thickness, are going to be the most desirable material. Spring steel, high carbon steel are good, but they're not quite as stiff. And you don't want your lockpick bending or getting weak and breaking, like that one that I made. I've got several in my pouch here that are in really bad shape because they were just made of crappy materials. So, I mean, you can make these out of any kind of metal. This is a piece of coat hanger wire that I've bent and filed and hammered down into a tension tool. And that one, you notice if I put it in the top there, it completely keeps out of the way. I've got all this room to work. So, obviously, these work. You saw me open that one. They're not going to work for everything, but if you want to get started with the locksport as a hobby, these were under $10. They're the cheapest set I could find on eBay, and they seem to do the job. They're all made out of this. No, actually, are they? Yeah, they're all made out of the same metal, and I can bend it, but it's pretty tough to bend. This one is a rake for a dimple lock. A dimple lock is those ones where the key is just a flat bar with holes drilled inside of it. So I'm unlikely to use this one. So let's just see how it... And actually, that is stronger than I expected. So I think these... Value for money? Yeah, they're... What, 75 cents per item in the kit? Got one that I doubt that I'm ever going to use. May not use that one very often. That's a sort of a rakey thing, I guess. And raking is basically just, you know, put the pick in and put some tension on it and just put it in and run it quickly against the pins. Sometimes you can get them to open quickly like that if it's not a very high quality lock. Other times it'll take forever. So other things that these picks here, again, since I'm trying to sort of review them and I suck at reviewing, will they do tiny locks like this drawer lock? The picks might, but the tension tool won't. You'll want a tension tool that's a lot narrower so it keeps out of your way. So it's a good beginner's kit, I guess. It's not going to take you into competitive lockpicking. It's not going to take you into locksmithing, where you would be opening a customer's lock for them. But value for money, not too bad at all. I'm not regretting this purchase. Something that I probably should have mentioned is about lock picking as a hobby or lock sport is that there is an accepted ethics surrounding it. And that is that you don't pick a lock that you don't own or that you don't control. And you don't, and a general recommendation is you don't pick a lock that's in use. So even though you own the lock in your front door, don't pick that because the pick could break in there. You could break the lock if you're not careful, and then you're hosed. So only pick locks that are not in use and that are yours and that you know you have permission by the legal owner of the lock to pick. Okay. Rant over. Video over. Bye.